This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we're talking to George Knapp and Jeremy Corbell, who almost at this point in time need no introduction. If you turn on any big news site, you're going to find them sooner or later for sure. George is an old friend. We've talked together many times on his show, and I think you might have been on my show once or twice in the past. Jeremy's new to Dreamland, and I'd like to start by asking you, Jeremy, how you got involved in this whole thing in the first place.
Yeah, well, I think like a lot of people, I was hit with this news in 1989. I was 13 years old, and I heard George Knapp interviewing Bob Lazar. And it was the way Bob Lazar described the propulsion system. It flipped my script. It was this idea that instead of a reactionary system where you push something out the back to go forward, which is how like roller skates and rockets work, everything we know works that way. He described a gravity amplification system where you fall into time and space, a field propulsion system. And I was young, I was 13, but I absorbed it. The way that George did the interview with Bob, the way that Bob described it, it really affected me. I thought, wow, you know, if we all kind of agree this is a big universe and there's probably life forms homogeneous throughout our known universe, then why couldn't they be more advanced and use a technology that makes that distance between far places and here irrelevant? And so that's how I initially got interested. My curiosity was weaponized. I became an active participant. But really, I was a martial arts guy. I did martial arts. That's all I ever thought I would do. And then I got injured and I couldn't train. And I had a total identity crisis. And part of that was I started trying to talk with people to find out if Bob Lazar was telling the truth. And one of my first calls was to George Knapp. He just ignored me for 2 years. So I had to stalk him. And I was finally, after like 2 years, one of the most surreal phone calls of my life is George's producer and calls me. My hands are all dipped in paint. I'm in the middle of an art show. I never expected to get called back after 2 years. And he says, "Hold for George Knapp." And I go, "What? Wait, what?" And they say, "Hold for George Knapp." And I go, George, okay. And then he goes, "Can I give you a piece of advice?" And George, I don't even know which producer this was who called me. I don't know.
Jim Russell.
Okay. And it was the most surreal. I was like, advice is great. And he says, "Know exactly what you want to say, make it brief and get to your point. You're not going to have much time." So I'm like sweating it. Okay. You know, wait like the longest wait ever. And comes on the phone. This is George, which by the way, he still answers the phone that way, even though there's like caller ID with my photo on it every time. And I just go in this rant and I'm like, "George, my name is Jeremy Corbell. I've been filming and trying to make a documentary. I'm not a filmmaker yet, but I'm going to make a film. It's going to be about Bob Lazar, maybe that kind of thing. I just want to know. I'm just trying to get closer to the truth. Is there any way you can help me?" I spit it out and there's this long silence. And I thought he just hung up the phone. Maybe he was just eating a sandwich, because all of a sudden he takes this deep breath and he goes, "All right, I'm going to do my part." And he launches into this hour long filling me in. I couldn't believe it after 2 years of trying to get a hold of George. So that's how I got started. George did his part and he contributed to an unknown person.
George is an enabler in this whole wild thing. Okay, now we're going to go back in time to a period so long ago that Methuselah had hair. And George, I'm going to ask you how you got started.
John Lear. John Lear walks into the TV studio one day in 1987, and we knew his family name, of course, here in Nevada, Learjet. His father had developed the 8-track tape, the Learjet, and some other things, and was well known in aviation and aerospace circles. And John had been a decorated pilot. He's flown everything in the world. He had run for the state senate. he had helped us, our news organization, KLS, break a really big story. The story was the stealth fighter, the F-117, this mysterious plane being developed at a place called Area 51 that was invisible to radar. And my boss, my friend, my mentor, Ned Day, had got the information, broke the story. We did it on the air. He did it in the newspaper. And it was a really big story. And so John had some credibility with us. So he walked into the studio one day with a stack of UFO, what I learned later were UFO documents, and put them on the desk of Ned Day. I'm eavesdropping, as I tend to do. And he gives this stuff to Ned. And he says, Ned, this is your next big story. It's the biggest cover-up of all time. It's the UFO story, and it's gigantic, and it's real, and you got to look into it. And Ned looks at the pile of papers, a couple of these things. He reads it, and he pushes it back toward Lear, and he goes, this can't be real. If it was real, I'd already know about it. That's what he says. So Lear picks up his stack. He's heading out of the building, and I said, hey, let me take a look at that. Plop it down here. I'll take a look at it. And I started reading, and I thought, well, that's pretty interesting. And At the time, I produced a 30-minute public affairs show that would air Saturday or Sunday morning at 7 o'clock a.m. Nobody watched it. I'd have a city councilman or a county commissioner or some gaming figure on it. I figured, what the heck? I'll put Lear on this thing. And we did. We did a 30-minute interview with him, and I just let him go. And that was really my first exposure to UFO world and all the crazy angles that Lear shared with me. And I was kind of dumbfounded about it. I didn't know much of anything about the UFO topic. It's like all of us. We have some interest in it, some level of interest through our lives, wondering what there is to it. But so Lear had started my education. And from 87 to 89, I started reading a little bit about what was going on. And one of the first books I read was Communion. And of course, people who haven't read Communion in a while, you think it's an alien abduction story, but it's so much more. There's so much more of an education about the visitors and our government. And, you know, and it helped me get my footing. And then in 1989, I get an inkling about this guy named Bob Lazar. Didn't know his name, but Lear had hinted that he knew some guy who worked out at Area 51. He was working on alien technology. And I reached out to him one day. We had a live guest at our 5 o'clock news show. We'd save a 5-minute interview segment and we'd do the interviews live. And I was anchoring the 5 o'clock at that point. And we had a cancellation late in the day. And I thought to myself, well, hey, I wonder if Lear's flying saucer guy would be willing to talk to me. I had no idea what was going on in Lazar's life at that time, but he had been through the ringer. He'd been through hell. And we just called up and said, hey, would that guy do an interview? And they worked it out. We sent a photographer up to Lear's house with a live unit. We blacked out Lazar's face and did the Dennis interview. And that changed my life. Basically, the following weekend, my news director and I went up to meet Lazar, grilled him for a couple of hours about his background and education and work experience. And we came out of it thinking, holy crap, what if this is real? This would be the biggest story of all time. We knew it was risky, that our reputations would be on the line. So we decided, well, maybe we'll work on a long-term project. And that project became a 9-part series, UFOs, the Best Evidence, that aired in November of 1989, Las Vegas. And it blew up. It just blew up. It went all over the world. You were one of my first interviews for that, Whitley.
I remember it very well.
You didn't know me from Adam, but you were gracious with your time. We did a satellite interview. It was key to what we put together, and it just exploded from there. And then from that point on, I became the UFO guy. And that was the moment when I went, quote, bull goose loony, in the words of one of the newspaper columnists who regularly teed off on me and have continued to do so ever since.
And I wonder if they will continue to do so now, because you guys are at the center of what is going to turn out to be the most profound cultural change in human history. We are beginning to face something that we haven't been able to face before, that we're not alone. And it's just the beginning. But I want to ask you, Jeremy, when you realized that you could, you had something that you could use, the social media primarily, which is where you mostly live, on Instagram, to get this stuff out there in a whole new way. What were your thoughts as to what you wanted to get out there?
Yeah, well, you know, for me, the journey was a little bit different in the sense that I didn't know how a martial athlete would get access to military witnesses, to journalists who won't call me back. You know, I didn't have an access point besides being curious. So this weird thing happened. I got a little digital camera for a gift. And I realized that the moment I pointed my camera at somebody, they would spill the beans. They'd spill the beans. It was like as if this camera was a passport into the unknown or the underworld, things that aren't talked about. And that was really my entrance point before I thought about sharing with the world. I thought about how do I learn more and how do I get the information that's not really being talked about or people are reluctant to talk about. So if we really back up, I'm an accidental filmmaker. The film I made was not the films I made. They were not intended. The intent was to learn more. And so the camera became this passport. And then, you know, during this, Instagram was created. Instagram didn't exist before this. And so I was one of the embryonic adopters of Instagram. If you go back to my account, you'll see the first photos at the very beginning when it started. What has happened is media has transformed from being something that is hard to edit and film, and it's become so easy now. And then the transmission latency is so minute. So social media has become places to break stories. And that's precisely what George and I are doing. So that's right. The evolution of how to use something like social media. So now I'm at a position where when George and I are going to break some news, we're like, we got to get it out hot and fast and then start clarifying. So we use social media as the nexus, a beginning point, you know, for any of these atomic drops, if that answers your question.
Well, yeah, sure it does. And George, if I may ask, you're in a situation where you are pumping this out and in behind what you're pumping out are things like the abduction experience and the experiencer community. And it so far it's working very well. The media is fixated on what my wife used to call the theater in the sky. And she used to say, would they be there if they didn't want to be seen? Of course not. They would. They do want to be seen. Now we're finally recognizing their presence. There's not a long path from there to someone somewhere on some show saying, well, what about the abductions? Like Joe Rogan, he won't, as you know, you've talked about me on his show with him. He won't have me on the show. And he won't because I'm a bridge too far in a way still. But what happens when we start to cross that bridge and the general public begins to realize that, hey, there's something not only to the things in the sky, but to what these people who have had something happen to them are saying?
Well, I'll tell you, Whitley, I'm sure you feel it too after being at this for so long, like me, but longer than I am. But the ground is shifting under our feet. The changes that are underway right now, I never thought I would live to see. You know, it's 30 plus years that I have been chasing this, really trying to educate the public to ingest and then sort of encapsulize a lot of information about this and try to make people understand that it's real and that it's important and that it's not going away. And it's been a long, lonely slog, I'll tell you, for doing these stories. I know there are other reporters who've covered the subjects here and there. They'll do a sweeps story or a newspaper special, but nobody sticks with it and still maintains work for a mainstream news organization. Thank God I work for KLAS and they trusted me to approach this subject in the same way I approach any other subject, you know, any other topic, any other news story. So I've tried to be, look for credible people and credible information and boil it down and put it in understandable terms. And it's a steep learning curve. It was for me. I'm still learning, of course. I'm still trying to figure stuff out and trying to share that with the public and bring them along a step at a time in a way that does not go too far, that isn't a bridge too far, as you're saying. So when I did that first series in 89, UFO's Best Evidence, with Lazar was sort of the headline. He was the punctuation point, but it was part of a much broader explanation of the subject, including abductions, experiences, experiencers, and you have to put it in context. So it's been a long slog, as I said, but it's finally happening now. And again, I never thought I would see it in my lifetime. You've got 60 Minutes doing a story about the Tic Tac stuff that Jeremy and Jeremy and I actually broke that story ourselves years ago. The New York Times did it later. But 60 Minutes might be the turning point, a point at which the genie can't be stuffed back into the bottle. New York Times in December 2017 started this process, made it acceptable for other media to cover it. So the Washington Post and the LA Times and other publications that looked into it, repeated their story, did additional follow-ups. And, you know, but I think not everyone reads the New York Times or reads the New Yorker or the Washington Post, but everybody watches television and watch 60 Minutes. If we don't watch it live, we watch it on social media. But that point, I think it's beyond the tipping point. And the changes that are happening right now, never thought I'd see it coming. But I'm happy. I'm happy about it because this subject deserves this kind of scrutiny. It needs big news organizations with resources to tackle it instead of me, the crazy UFO reporter in Las Vegas, and wacky filmmaker Jeremy Corbell. But we have to help point the way for a lot of those big, big players.
Well, okay, we're going to free Dreamlanders. You're going to spend a couple of minutes now with some things that are even wackier than Jeremy and George and me, if that's possible. The rest of us, the subscribers, will keep right on keeping on.
When you start to ask the question, it unfolds. The fabric of space itself, how it's made, what is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here,
and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook,
and kindle.
We're talking to George Knapp and Jeremy Corbell today. MysteryWire.com is where to go if you want to keep up with what George is doing. If you can keep up with George is doing, also his Sunday night edition of Coast to Coast AM, followed by many, many people for a good reason. It's a place where much news has been broken over the years. Jeremy Corbell is pushing his stuff mostly to social media. He does have a website, extraordinarybeliefs.com, but if you want to get with Jeremy, follow him on Instagram. Would that be right, Jeremy?
Yeah, all yeah. social media.
Okay, now, we've been talking a little bit about the past, and, you know, I have a past in this myself. I'm a military kid, and like many military kids, in fact, one of them we're going to be interviewing on Dreamland shortly, called Matthew Roberts, who was on the Roosevelt during the Gimbel incident and became engaged with the visitors. That happens. When I was a little boy, I was groomed for this by my father, who was involved in some way. He's too tight-lipped, I don't know. I, among other things that happened in my childhood, was that Colonel Guy Hicks, who was the base commander at the base where the Mantell incident occurred in 1947, ended up living down the street from us.
Huh.
And well, there was no accident in that. And I was sent over to play with his children and then very gently interrogated by my dad. If you wanted to keep a secret in my house, it was really hard to do because you couldn't tell when dad was interrogating you or not. And the man missed nothing. So anyway, and then his brother, Mickey, was involved in the Roswell incident at Wright Field. He was one of the officers who tried to reassemble the debris with Art Exon. And it's a family thing, and it is in a lot of cases. Yeah. I wonder if either of you have any family background of in this that you know about. How about you, George? Was anyone in your family ever interested in this before it came into your life? Or do you have a military background?
I don't. It's a story I'm not ready to tell. Whenever I get asked the question whether I've had an experience or people in my family have had an experience, I just answer, my standard answer is not that I remember. But there are some, there's a trail of phenomena in my family that I will share at some point. And one of them, I'll just tell you, well, here he is. He's grilling me, Jeremy. I'm about to spill.
Yeah, spill the beans, George.
Feel it.
UFO experience in my life, but that my parents had shared with me because it was too young for me to remember. But it actually turns out to be a fairly famous case, a series of incidents that happened in the late 50s. That I'll the first time I tell the story, Whitley, it'll be with you, but I'm not ready to tell it now.
Okay. Well, we know it's there, and that's a step in the right direction. How about you, Jeremy? Before you sort of stumbled on the Bob Lazar story, was there anything in your life that might have caused you to kind of gravitate toward this or open your mind to it?
No, I never. What truly did it was the science and technology described by Bob Lazar. That's the only thing. I mean, you know, I think like most people, you have experiences that you can't quantify in the same way as your normal daily, everyday experiences. You know, I think everybody has that.
Right.
But as far as a very specific generational UFO presence in the family that I grew up with, no, nothing. The only thing that comes close to that, and this was a shocker to me, when I was in the middle of an art career, I went and harvested these windows out of a house in Santa Monica Palisades. When it was under construction, they were tearing it down. And I put in these windows this huge image of the Battle of Los Angeles, this event where I think it was 1942.
Yes, it was 42.
Yeah. So this object, you know, goes over Los Angeles, and they did, you know, 1,400 rounds of like 12-pound mortars and shot them up. And it was a big event. People died from the shrapnel and heart attacks from it happening. We thought we were under attack. It was right after Pearl Harbor, I think. And what I didn't know is I placed this huge window installation in one of my art shows with this image right out of the Los Angeles Times of this object, as if you're looking out the window, as if you were, you know, there. And my grandma comes and looks at it. She goes, "Oh, I saw that." And I was like, "You what?" And she said, I saw that. That's why I'd sit with your mom out on the front lawn on the weekends to look in the sky. That's why I'd take her to Joshua Tree and Pioneer Town when she was a kid, was because we had seen that. And we had always been looking to the skies since then. I actually recorded my grandmother telling me this story. Unreal. So she saw this huge event that all of LA saw, and she had never mentioned it to anybody in our family. She never told my mom why they'd sit out on the front lawn and look to the sky, but that was why. So that would be the closest thing to, you know, a family experience of it.
You know, I'm going to shift now that we kind of know you two guys in a slightly different way than you usually end up being presented in most of the media that you appear on. And I want to shift now to a small way to some the question of things like social engineering. I noticed that 2 weeks before The New Yorker published its piece about Leslie Keen and a very complimentary, basically, piece about her work. There was a piece about Elizabeth Loftus, the false memory syndrome expert. And the piece about Elizabeth Loftus was very disturbing. What was disturbing about it was that it did not contain anything about the False Memory Syndrome Foundation and its founders. Elizabeth Loftus has been a member, and their daughter, Jennifer Freed, wrote a book called Betrayal Trauma about the fact that they had abused her. And she was also a highly trained psychologist and explained in her book why it was that childhood trauma is not necessarily always false memories. Now, there was also on a website, the name of which I will not mention on the air, because I believe it to be a website connected to the intelligence community that plays in the UFO world. There was a thing about how hypnosis causes false memories. You put those two things together, and I begin to see a possibility that we're going to be looking at the close encounter witnesses, who were, many of them watch this show, this is their show, are going to be denied their rights, as it were, to express their question into the public space. And I'd like you two to just riff on that if you want to. And if you haven't thought about it, don't worry about it. We'll go on to something else. But George, what is your response there? I can understand Joe Rogan not wanting me on his show because he's afraid I'll talk about things that are so weird it'll put his audience off. And, you know, I probably would.
Well, it seems like, you know, right now we're riding this gigantic tsunami wave of media coverage. And mainstream, these major news organizations are playing catch up. They're trying to get to the point where Jeremy and I have been for a long time and get caught up and educate their readers. And it's generally a positive move. There will be a backlash. There's going to be a backlash. It's inevitable because, you know, we've seen it. Whitley, you've been the victim of it for a long, long time. Me too. The kind of pushback that journalists, news organizations, maybe somebody from the top in their organizations have inflicted on the subject matter. Something like that kind of shows the power of the media to bit put bits and pieces together and push back on the narrative. And it's coming. It will happen because, you know, the move toward some form of disclosure or acknowledgement, we're getting closer and closer to what I would call like the beginning of the end of an acknowledgement by society in general that this is real, that the visitors have always been with us, and we need to figure out what the agenda is. That will be an important point when or if we get to it, that we as a nation, as a country, decide we're going to try to figure out what it is and what it's up to, as opposed to, is it real? The example that you used, I think we're going to see a lot of it. The mainstream media has been a tool to pummel people who are trying to get to the bottom of this mystery for a long time.
Yeah, I've noticed.
Yeah. And I don't know that it's organized, that somebody is ordering it. I would not be surprised that in some instances that is the case, but it'll happen again. It's coming soon. You can bet that there are knives being sharpened right now to go back and attack the people who are pushing for greater disclosure. That's my feeling in it anyway. Jeremy?
Well, how do you respond?
Yeah, well, what specifically is the question?
Well, what happens to the UFO witnesses? The close encounter witnesses, do they get thrown under the bus at some point? Or is this going to evolve beyond that in the sense that the fact that they are part of the mystery will be acknowledged? I'm just not sure where it would be taken. There's two ways to go. There's a way to go that says too many people have had too much happen to them. And there's a way to go that says it's all false memories and hypnosis and they're all nuts.
Oh, no. We're so far past that. You can't say that Commander David Fravor had a false memory, and that you can't say that Commander David Fravor of the Tic Tac UFO, that he saw a reflection on the inside of his cockpit windshield, because we have radar data and other electro-optic systems that corroborate through multitudes of other eyewitnesses, as well as just the hard physical data. And that's the change now. That's the sea change. And you notice that with a lot of our new technologies, we're able to track, obtain footage. Could I have put out military filmed, high quality FLIR imagery, 15, 20, 35 years ago when George Knapp was doing this? No, you can't, because the entire way it's captured, collected, and even targeted is so different now. So what I'm saying is, with a technological advantage, with a technological shift that we're seeing where everybody's got a cell phone in their pocket, we are seeing and corroborating more encounters, because now we can put all of that data together. And what that does socially is that takes individuals who would be silent because they didn't want to lose their wings, or, hey, I've had such a weird experience, I can't tell people. You know better than all of us, George. You get a close encounter sighting from somebody, the end of the story is not that they saw something. There's always something more. They just don't want to tell you about it. So as we dissolve the stigma with hard physical evidence that's corroborated through multiple sensor systems, it's a type of permission that is being given, not just to our military heroes and, assets within our, armed forces, but also just civilians, people who have seen and reported and recorded and documented what they've experienced. They are given permission now too. So it's kind of like a large wave that's washing over everything, that is allowing people to feel comfortable in telling what happened to them. So that's the difference now. We are in a new era. There's no going back. You cannot throw these witnesses under the bus. It's going to be impossible. And that doesn't mean that everybody's telling the truth. That's not to mean that everybody's story is correct, even by how they're portraying it. And that certainly doesn't mean that everything seen in the sky that's unknown is from somewhere else. It doesn't mean any of that. But what it does mean is that we are in a new era of information exchange that is conducive to proper relaying of stories. And that's a very powerful thing.
It's a levels of acceptance, Whitley, as you know well. I mean, that people can be comfortable with the idea that there are machines in the sky that may be from other planets. We've been conditioned to accept that. Movies and TV shows. Yeah, that's a nice, comfortable box. We can get used to that. How bad can it be? And then as you learn more about it, you recognize that this phenomena has been with us throughout human history. People are going to be less comfortable with that. They're going to be very uncomfortable with the kind of experiences that you've had. When you tell people that these visitors have been with you since childhood and they come through the walls and they take you away and they have been manipulating human affairs for a long time, it's going to take some time for people to get their heads around it. And sometimes no one will. But when experiencers come forward, that they remain shy. They're comfortable talking to other experiencers about this really weird stuff that's happened to them. When they come forward, they're going to get bashed. It's inevitable. It'll happen.
Yeah, it'll happen again. I've been there and done that for a while now. Okay, we've come up on a break again, and Free Dreamlanders, enjoy these commercials. They're all brilliant, and they will all convince you to do whatever it is they tell you to do, and I need that, so please do it.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
Okay, we're back with Jeremy and George. And when we were during break, I mentioned to them that a book called The Communion Letters that was edited by Ann Strieber, which contains 100 exemplary letters from the huge hoard of letters that we received after the publication of Communion, which was hundreds of thousands of letters, and maybe even more than a million, it's quite possible. And she and her secretary edited these letters in the sense of they separated them from the ones that said, well, great book, thank you, the ones that had a real good description of something. And of those that had descriptions, she narrowed it down to 100 letters and put them in the book. And they give you a very good idea of the incredible diversity of this experience. The whole group of letters that she saved are now in an archive at Rice University, thanks to Dr. Jeffrey Kripal. Now, we have mentioned the past and the fact that this is something that has arcs probably across the whole human past. That tells me we need to get the academic community involved in this, not just the scientific community. These letters are a question for social science, psychology, psychiatry, biology, and brain science. You mentioned Kit Green, who of course is engaged in studies in neurology, in neurological science. Now, when people start to come out and tell even the least strange stories in the media. You mentioned, I mean, we know there are people in the military who have very strange and extraordinary stories. What's his name? Matthew Roberts is one of them from the Gimbel incident. And there are many more whose stories have a basis in fact. In other words, there are physical aspects to the story that can be identified. So, George, and I want you to both answer this question as best you can. What happens when somebody comes out and tells somebody who is believable and tells an incredibly weird story about their lives?
I think they'll get pounded. The same stuff that you went through when you came out with Communion. You know, you wrote that book, and even for people who did not read it, the image that stared out of that the cover, that being that was on the cover, it grabbed people. It struck a nerve somewhere. It was a memory that was deep inside their heads, and they related to it even before right. They saw what was inside. It grabbed them because the experience is far more common than any of us are willing to admit. You know, right now what's happening is mainstream media, thankfully, are taking it seriously. They're looking at cases like the Tic Tac, and 60 Minutes did that. But that's kind of low-hanging fruit. That's the bottom level. That's great right. level. Yeah, there are things in our sky, and we don't know what they are. As you dig deeper, though, and you get into the idea that these, whatever this intelligence is, it's always been with us. It has helped shape human affairs. It has profoundly affected individual lives. And then when they tell their stories about their individual encounters, they're going to get whacked, a lot of them. I remember having the pushback from when we would report on abduction experiences, because these are individual experiences and there might be some physical evidence, but you don't have the kind of data and footage that Jeremy has helped to document for these individual things. So, yeah, I think right now what's happening is a good positive thing. But when these same reporters dig a little bit deeper, they're going to have a hard time swallowing the kinds of experiences that are very real and very common. But are not as easily documented.
Not as easily talked about either. Yeah. Jeremy, where do you think that this will go, just in general? Because a narrative has started, a really solid narrative has now been embedded in the public space, and it's going to go somewhere. It's going to go somewhere past the UFOs, and the report that's hopefully coming up, although I do know that there is an attempt going on to get a continuance on it, and we'll have to see if that works out. Hopefully not. In any case, where will we go from there?
I mean, look, it is the goal to have a greater understanding of the nature of reality? You know, to me, that's the goal. I think they call that epistemological. I looked that word up in the dictionary. It seems to me that that's, you know, has to do with the boundaries of accepted reality, if I'm getting that right. So,
yeah,
right. So that's kind of the goal, you know, is to better understand the nature of reality. Because if we do that, then we can really understand how to navigate as human beings in this kind of cosmic universe. Now that's a tall order. So how do you get there? And I think that, you know, we start really simply with what do we know for sure? We know for sure that UFOs represent hard physical craft. Now it might be much bigger than that, might be much stranger than that, but you know, there are hard physical craft. So let's just start there. Like, do we have one? Does our military have that technology somewhere hidden away? Do they have more than 9 of them? That'd be interesting. So I think that once we start at this very basic fundamental level, that there are physical objects that fly with impunity in our restricted airspaces over sensitive nuclear installations, and people have been seeing these, and they have been part of the human experience since at least the beginning of recorded human history, if not before, then we can start saying, well, if that is the case, what other things do we know? Like, what is the mass of reporting? What is the critical mass of reporting? Well, as you know, Whitley, the critical mass of reporting is that a lot of these interactions are personal, that they're not just lights in the sky. So we have to start somewhere. And although it might be a much larger thing going on, I suspect it is. I learned that, reluctantly learned that through George and what we experienced and what he's reported on through Skinwalker Ranch. For me, that was an eye opener. So obviously, you know, if you look at a sphere in a two-dimensional reality, you see a circle at any angle. And that's the limit of our perception. And I think the UFO topic is very similar to that. I think that we're seeing one layer or facade to a much more dramatic reality, but we got to start somewhere. So I'm really focused on the nuts and bolts, not because I think that's the ultimate reality, but because I think that's going to get us towards the ultimate reality, whatever that might be.
I think that's exactly the right place for you to be. George has been too much in the other world. You've talked to me on your show. You've talked to many abductees on your show. I think that there are a couple of bridges here. And one of the reasons I'm so interested in what you're doing, Jeremy, is that Bob Lazar is one of those bridges. Because Bob Lazar hasn't had an abduction experience, but so he knows. I mean, but you don't know what's people. Well, like my listeners already know, I've talked about this before. I had a missing time experience a few days ago, right before a meeting with Danny Sheehan.
Oh, I see what you're saying. We don't know what we don't know. That's
exactly
true.
Exactly. We don't know what we don't know. So Bob Lazar must know people in the military who have had interface, because it's not just the abduction phenomenon in the military. There are intuitives who interface. I'm well aware of that. If either of you have ever heard of anything like that.
You might be surprised, though, what Bob Lazar doesn't know. I mean, George, maybe you want to take that?
Yeah, Bob is kind of an outsider. He was when he was an insider. And he's tried to leave this behind because it's been nothing but bad for his life. But I know what you mean. There are people in the military and in intelligence agencies. If you just take a percentage of the general population that's had these experiences, whether they want to talk about them or not, you know that there are people in government who's had them as well. I will wager that some of these nuts and bolts saucer cases, like the Tic Tac, that some of those pilots have carried something else with them. They have a sighting, it's well documented, and you think, wow, that was really cool. But I will bet you that there are at least one or two of them in the well-publicized incidents who've had continuing experiences because of that close encounter. That comes with the territory.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
If I always say to the people working on the materials, if you look at the materials, they're going to be looking back at you because if you're interested, then they're interested in you.
The Tic Tac and those things, those are like low hanging fruit, and I'm glad they're being covered. But the more complicated stuff, the more complicated experiences, that's going to take some time for my media brethren to go ahead and get their heads around. You know, I think these UFO incidents happen on purpose. I don't think it's accidental. I know that Jeremy and I might disagree on this, but Dave Fravor described the Tic Tac, that it was doing something when his F-18 came flying along. Probably was, but I don't think that it was accidental. I think it was like a stage thing. Like the Tic Tac is there doing something in the water. Now, oh gosh, there's an F-18 there. I didn't know there was F-18s in this area. Come on. It wanted to be seen. I think they're showing
exactly
as a level of acceptance. So they make these displays, or as Bob Bigelow said, he's called it performances. Same thing at Skinwalker Ranch. He was drawn there because there were UFOs and orbs. But then he gets to the ranch, he and his team, and they discover a much broader universe of weird crap. And it's a learning curve. You have to learn the levels one at a time. And we're still up at level one. I mean, Whitley, you'll remember this, but ufology, which seemingly is supposed to be interested in this stuff, for the first couple of decades of ufology, these organizations did not want to admit that these craft that are being seen might have beings inside them.
Yeah, I know that very well.
What? They're beings inside? Holy, I can't believe that. That's a bunch of crap.
Right.
I realize it. And then with Communion and Missing Time, Bud Hopkins' book, when you guys changed the narrative in such a dramatic way, it took years, even for ufologists who were already interested in it, to come to grips with it. So right. it's going to take the general public a lot longer too.
Yeah, the nature of the contacts, George, and you know, I'm not disagreeing because I don't know, but it appeared to me that with the Tic Tac UFO case, that it was just doing something. That was kind of the way that I, you know, experienced the information. It was just doing something, and then, you know, Commander Favor rolls up on it with his posse, and all of a sudden it notices him, mirrors him, does a performance. It's gone. It's at his cap point within a second, which is, you know, 60 miles away, which how did this technology or the occupants of this vehicle or the intelligence controlling this vehicle know where he was going? That's something people don't talk about. That's almost magical because it's all encrypted communications of where his cap point is. He might not even know at that moment where his next task is, where he's going. So there is this kind of strange thing. I'm not discounting that it was intentional and it was a performance and it could have been, but the nature of these contacts is transforming dramatically. So back in the day, we had Foo Fighters that would almost as if you'd send a probe to film warplanes and show what's going on during wars. I mean, almost like entertainment, like there's a an intergalactic history channel and they're documenting these crazy people on Earth and what they're doing. That would be a cool show. But then, you know, I do have a sense that what was going on with the Tic Tacs is they were performing tasks that were unrelated to their performance to us. I could be wrong, but that was the idea that I kind of got from it. However, the 2019 swarms around, and I have the complete list now of which vehicles were in the area as far as Navy ships. Wow, there were
incredible.
Yeah, and there were a lot. And so what, and everybody was experiencing a similar type of engagement, a little bit different here and there, colors of lights, kind of shapes of objects, but it was happening all at the same time, two different sets of events within July, over multiple days, each set of events. So now you've got these really brazen, lit up, bright encounters. That's my dog, by the way. We got to acknowledge him. That's Wiley.
Yeah, that's great. They're here too.
Yes. So, you know, he does not care about UFOs, by the way. He cares about food and hugs and water. Right. So these brazen encounters that are they are performances. So George, there we are. There's no way around it. Those were performances that were almost antagonistic in a way. They're trying to get a reaction, maybe, you know, get information. However, the response from the individuals who are tasked with defending that airspace was very strange to me. And I have direct knowledge of this, and I know you do too, George, is that these individuals, they didn't feel threatened. It was like they were more in awe of what was going on, which is so interesting because I have been told by the individuals who are tasked to defend this war space, this airspace, that they feel like they failed in their duties and they don't know why they didn't pursue this to identify these things more. That was their job. So it's a very strange thing when you're talking about how Commander Fravor engaged the Tic Tac. It was curiosity. You know, he said, I went down and tried to engage the thing and it started mirroring me and boom, it was gone. He's like, whoa, that did something far beyond anything we could do. How did it even notice me and then move in a way? So what I'm saying is that there's this sense of curiosity to these performances that makes people act a little differently than they would normally act, you know, yeah. Just some, you know, MiG or something from Russia. I mean, it's a very strange thing that the nature of these encounters seems to be more brazen now.
Yeah. One of the letters that we have from a communion reader was from a Navy man who was on a carrier in 1957 that was visited by a gigantic cylindrical object twice as long as the carrier. And the reaction aboard the ship was everybody went to their knees.
Wow, really?
They went to their knees. And these guys and women who were experiencing the Tic Tacs and these other UFOs are reacting in a similar way.
There were two reactions, Whitley. There were two reactions. So Alex, who was the pilot that came out on 60 Minutes, she was a newer pilot. So her experience was there was a sense of fear. Like, what is this? Why didn't they? We have no weapons. What is this? What do I have to do? Am I going to have to ram my plane into this thing to defend our country? There was a sense of fear. Commander Fravor had a sense of absolute curiosity. I want to fly one of these. Who's operating this? Let me get close and see if I can wave to him. What's going on?
You know, it occurs to me in the abduction close encounter world, I could maybe introduce him to someone who has flown one. But I can't prove it, so there's no point in that. But there's
That'd
a lot
so
of
cool.
stories
I
like that
so,
out
man.
There.
I hope so.
Me too. All right. I would like to now turn to someone who's kind of a ghost in this room. I mean, he is a very ghostly guy in his own way. He's very private. It's Bob Bigelow, who I regard as a real hero here. I mean, he's been criticized and sucked up in the conspiracy theory world, et cetera, and so forth. But Bob put his money where his mouth was. He bought the Skinwalker Ranch. He sent people out there. He spent millions of dollars. And the guy goes on 60 Minutes a couple of years ago and says brazenly, I had an encounter with aliens. Now, I consider that heroic. I know what it's like to say a thing like that in public. Of course, he was insulated a little better than I was because he's got all the money and a lot of power. But still, it took guts to do that. And I'd like to talk about, if the two of you can talk a little bit about Bigelow and just be frank about what you think his role was. I know he's now more interested in afterlife, and we'll talk about the connection between all of this and stuff like the afterlife in the next half hour. But let's talk about Bob now. George, I know you both know Bob, but why don't you lead us off in telling us about your experience of Bob?
Robert Bigelow has been a friend of mine for 31, 32 years. So he was right after we finished the Lazar segments and that Best Evidence, that first series that I did in 1989, I got a call from him. I'd never heard of him before. And his secretary says, hold for Robert Bigelow. And so I talked to him and he said, boy, that was great. Can I help support your work? Meaning he wanted to help fund additional research or TV stories. I said, no, I appreciate the offer, but I work for a TV station. I can't do that. And within a month, he had tracked down Lazar. They were hanging out, invited me to join this little circle. We would meet every week or so at a little bar near where I lived and talk over UFO matters. He had already been interested. His family had had experiences. He was also interested in survival of consciousness, afterlife issues, even then. And then he started funding research by individuals, Linda Howe, Stan Friedman, Bud Hopkins. And he offered money to the UFO organizations because that was what they always said they needed. They didn't have enough funds to do good work. So he offered them money and they screwed it up. So he created his own UFO organization, NIDS, the National Institute for Discovery Science. We mentioned Kit Green's name earlier. Kit was on the Science Advisory Board, along with an amazing array of people, Jacques Vallée, Dr. Edgar Mitchell, Dr. Hal Puthoff, and a number of other people. And in those early days of NIDS, it had two responsibilities. What about life in the universe? Are UFOs and ETs real? And what happens to us when we die? Eventually, NIDS became better known for its focus on UFOs and related issues than the afterlife. That sort of went away. But he was interested in both from the beginning, and he spent more money in pursuing truth and evidence than any person in the history of the world. That's just tens of millions of dollars.
I agree with you, and I think I've often wondered why he never came into contact with me. Bud told me that he had made sure that Bob Bigelow never would get near me. And so, Bud and I, you know, something happened. What basically after my book was published, it Bud kind of went ballistic because I was not on his narrative anymore. I was on my own narrative, one, and two, my book was incredibly successful in comparison with his, and he had spent his life in this, and I came waltzing in from the outside, and you know, it became an ego issue, and so he maybe muddied the waters there for me a little bit. But in any case, let's go on, Jeremy. You have also had experience with Bob. I want to honor him here.
Yeah.
Or have you?
George, yeah, George, you know, it's really interesting. I kind of admired the way that George was able to, I don't think people understand what, George, I'm sorry, you can leave this conversation if you don't want to hear praise about yourself, but I think the truth needs to be told. You know, a lot of what we're seeing is because of George Knapp.
I know, that's why he's here. He's a major figure here in this whole thing.
More than people know. So the thing is this, you know, George comes out with the Bob Lazar story, but the first person, and correct me if I'm wrong, George, but the first person outside of the newsroom that George reached out to was Senator Harry Reid. And that night, Reid, I have the footage. He goes on camera with George saying, I've heard what you're about to put out. It's very interesting. We're going to look into this. Wow. What a moment to set forward this domino effect of what happened. We now know Senator Harry Reid set up a program called AWSAP, a black budget program funded with two other Congress people and Senate people that essentially put together this AWSAP program, which is to study UFOs and associated phenomenon, where Skinwalker Ranch was kind of the impetus of this. None of this would have happened without George. So what happened is he tells Harry Reid, I think he kicked you out of his limo at some point, or I don't know. He did not kick you out of his limo. That was the thing. You tell him about Bob Lazar. And so here's Harry Reid and George Knapp whispering to each other for 30 years behind everybody's back, like building this understanding of what's going on. So, you know, enter Bob Bigelow and this whole thing. I would suspect that George Knapp kind of put everybody together, from the DIA to Harry Reid to Bob Bigelow. I don't think AWSAP would have existed if George Knapp didn't exist. I'm actually pretty sure of that. So it's interesting to me, just as a reporter, where George is just reporting the news, how he gets, you know, things moving in a way that helps the UFO topic, like way behind the scenes. So I know George was sitting on this story, and he could have published this a long time ago. He was the only journalist allowed at Skinwalker Ranch. He's the only journalist allowed in these rooms to be a fly on a wall during meetings. So it's so interesting to me that now here we are, and a lot has happened because of George's direct relationships to these individuals. And not to make it sound conspiratorial, it's not. It's just an unacknowledged aspect of all of this. So I think George has been the one that's reported correctly on everything throughout the whole way. He's explained to people that the $22 million was absorbed by BASS, which was, you know, funded to AWSAP, and that ATIP was an auxiliary but amazing program that communicated with AWSAP. So I think that George has really paved the way for a lot of this. And so, yeah, I got to meet, you know, Robert Bigelow. It was amazing. He's a really fascinating individual who I think deserves a credit and respect. I think George has been the one kind of driving that train the whole way, though, is just informing people and letting them know what's going on. So I don't know what your specific question was, but that was a real pleasure and an honor to go with George and Bigelow to see him go on the Joe Rogan podcast. I think that was great. I think there was a lot of tension in that podcast because I think a lot of stuff wasn't said that should have said. Joe should have asked Robert Bigelow about the one acknowledged UFO program that existed and was funded by the military. That question never came up. You know, I don't know why, but ultimately, I think that Robert Bigelow can speak for himself. But I think that the cool thing is that there's been a progression of information that has grown because of the hard work behind the scenes that's rarely acknowledged. George could have broke the the story the New York Times broke, and he would have done it accurately. But I think that he stepped aside to allow them to ring the bell louder for the good of the, for the greater good.
I would just thanks, Jeremy. I would just say, Whitney, in the beginning of this our conversation here, you mentioned about coincidences and synchronicities in your life.
Yeah, it
certainly plays a role in what Jeremy is describing here. I mean, I moved to Las Vegas. I didn't know there was a Nevada test site or an Area 51. I didn't know there was a guy named John Lear or Bob Lazar. I flipped a coin about whether I was moving to Las Vegas or Hawaii. The fact that I got to work for KLAS, maybe the only news organization in the country that would allow me to pursue this for decades without stopping me and making me do something else, is amazing. I didn't know that Harry Reid and Robert Bigelow lived here, but I covered Reid, his first campaigns for Congress, 82 and 84, and then for the Senate. And I knew him. So by 1989, when I start hearing this about Area 51, I go to talk to him about it confidentially. And we started a confidential conversation that continues to this day. And then when Bigelow created NIDS, I spoke at their first board meeting and about Russia UFOs. And then when I left it, I told Reid about it. I said, you won't believe the group of people that are around there, that table. One of them was, by the way, the sixth man to walk on the moon, Edgar Mitchell, and the other one was the last man to walk on the moon, Harrison Schmitt, who was a U.S. senator at the time. When I told him the makeup of that group, he said, hey, I'd like to go there. Do you think I can get an invitation? So he did. That laid the groundwork for pretty much everything that we're seeing today. NIDS became the model for BAS and OSAP. OSAP was the host program. ATIP was a corollary program, much smaller, that existed in D.C. and looked at military cases, but did not look at the broader range of phenomena that Bigelow and his team from Bass were looking at. So a lot of these stories that are making news now are traced right here to Las Vegas.
I want to back up a second here. George can't get away with saying he flipped a coin to move to Las Vegas and become a reporter. I know George's history before that, but I just want to hear that really, really clearly, George. So you flipped a coin to end up in Las Vegas, and that's like how you, this whole career, like, so what did you do when you first entered Las Vegas? Did you have a job prior to being a news reporter? How did you get the news reporter job?
I had met some bartenders in California who were from Las Vegas, and they're the craziest free-spirited people I'd ever seen. And I was teaching at, I was a debate coach at UC Berkeley at the time, tired of being poor, and was trying to think of what else I could do. And they said, well, we know a guy in Las Vegas who works for a TV station. You could move there and you'd be great. You can write, you can speak. You're a natural for TV. So I wanted to move to Hawaii, and my girlfriend then wanted to move to Las Vegas. So we flipped a coin and it came up Las Vegas. And my first job was driving. I drove a taxi cab for a while. I was maybe the worst taxi cab driver in history. And then I broke into as a production assistant, pod carrier, kind of a jack of all trades for a public television station. And I bugged them long enough to they let me go into the news department. And that's where it took off.
Amazing. Amazing. The flip of a coin. It's so much of human life depends on things like that. The flip of a coin. What a great story. I'm glad I asked the question. And Jerry, thank you for bringing that in. It's one of the marvelous stories in the history of my show, in my opinion. Now, I want to turn. We're going to normally at the end of the first hour, our free listeners are cut off and we just stay with subscribers. But I'm not going to do that this week because this is one of the more important shows we've ever done on Dreamland. And I'd like to now turn to this issue of threat or no threat. Right now, what's happening in the Senate is two committees are being going to be given this report, the Intelligence Committee and the Armed Services Committee. The Science Committee is not involved, as far as I know. And that's an important distinction because these are the two committees who oversee the parts of our government that assess and respond to threats. The Science Committee has a completely different agenda. Now, one of the reasons that the National Security Act was invoked, I know why it was invoked in the first place, because General Exum explained it to me in great detail at Roswell, because they didn't know whether or not this was a Russian spy craft, and they had the atomic bomber wing was, you know, right there at Roswell Army Air Field, and Stalin had 5 million men waiting to sweep into Western Europe, and those atomic bombers were the only thing that were stopping him. The problem was that the bombers weren't ready to go, and if they had sent a sensitive Geiger counter over that base, they would have known that the amount of radiation coming off of the base wasn't enough to explain the presence of atomic bombs. So it was an incredibly sensitive thing for purely military reasons initially. But then the National Security Act of 1947 contains statements to the effect that if the threat level of an unknown intrusion is not itself known, then it must remain classified, essentially. And this is the basis for all of the continuing classification of all of this. Now we have two committees that are only threat-oriented being given this information. And not all of it is going to be going out to the public. It's not going to be, some of it is going to be classified. Do you think, and you guys answer this each in your own way, there is a hidden threat here that somebody's not telling us about because they don't want to and they can't? Or is this whole business of it being a threat something that we have to find our way past in the sense that we have to accept the fact that the act demands that remain classified until we know whether or not it's a threat? But we're never going to know that for sure until we declassify it and find out more from the general scientific and academic communities what we think is going on.
Jeremy, you want to take that first?
Sorry for the long question. I apologize.
No, it's okay. You're just you're trying to distinguish. So I don't know if that is correct information, that the only people going to be informed by this report are, you know, threat assessment agencies. I didn't know that. I'm not sure that is accurate.
But, no, I didn't hear you. I'm sorry. There was a breakup in the sound, and it's important.
Oh, I'm sorry. I said I didn't know, and I am not confident with the fact of what you just said, which is that the only agencies that are being engaged are threat assessment agencies, and that I didn't know that if that's the case. I don't think that's the case. But George,
I see. Well, I could be wrong about that, but it remains true that the only two committees that are being involved here are the committees that deal with threat.
Well, let me make a brief statement. I think George can answer your question better on a totality. I would just like to say one very simple thing, which is that there's a lot of buzz around, like, when people use, like, so when I found some of the TikTok stuff, I had to put a very specific kind of a web bot out there to find terms that were more associated with threat, you know, than anything else. So I was able to find terminology that I know is being used on the inside so that I could find more information. Threat was one of those identifiers. Now, why is that? People get their panties in a bunch about it. Here's the deal. It's the job of the Department of Defense to defend. That's their job. Everything is right. A threat until identified otherwise, until we know the origin, intent, and capability. It's very simple. So the idea of, like, is this a threat or not a threat? I mean, I don't know. We could go all John Lear and say we're containers of souls and we're being harvested. I don't know. I mean, most likely the UFO presence has been here with us and what an associated phenomenon, you know, since way before maybe even humans were on planet Earth. So bottom line is it's the job of the DOD to assess threat. That's right. Their job. So why wouldn't they take that perspective? And I'm grateful they do. But
me too.
With that pushed aside, let me just push that aside for a second. I think George is much more capable and informed to kind of explain to you what the thought system is around this. So maybe, George, you can take that.
Well, I can tell you that back in the 90s, Robert Bigelow and his organization made some really great progress in trying to get Congress to take a look at it. And they used issues like what we're discussing now. They had a committee that was willing to have hearings based on the possible threat to aviation that pop up from time to time, near misses, near collisions between airliners and these unknowns. It was sort of an entry point for Congress to take a look at it that would not make Congress people look crazy. And I think right now what's happened is ATIP, which was the little program in the Pentagon that was left over after the money was pulled from OSAP, they focused entirely on national security cases, incidents where these unknowns interact with our military bases, with ICBM bases, with nuclear carriers and nuclear submarines. So yeah, they're if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And what they knew there was these things are doing surveillance of our military capabilities, in particular our nuclear capabilities. If the Tic Tac had a giant Chinese flag on it, it would be considered a threat. And so right now, although the visitors, these craft, the unknown ones, have not displayed any hostile intentions, the fact that they are in restricted airspace over sensitive installations, you have to at least consider the possibility that they're a threat. You need to investigate. And that's where I think it's a good thing that the Armed Services and Intelligence Committee are the ones that have taken this on and been willing to risk their political reputations to say, we need to look into this. And once you get past that threshold level, then you can bring in the science committees and the academic community to take a broader look at the phenomena. We right. know that it's not just nuts and bolts saucers in the sky. That's the demonstration. That's the performance. That's the twinkling light in the up there to get our attention. And they've done that. They've got our attention. So once we are able to say, all right, these are unknowns. They're not using giant laser beams to wipe out our cities. We need, all right, it may not necessarily be an imminent threat, but we need to find out what the heck it is. And the start would be, well, the excuse could be national defense, and then you broaden it to look at other subjects, like what Bass did, the OSAP program with Robert Bigelow. They were drawn to Skinwalker Ranch because of UFO sightings. And then they realized, holy crap, there's all kinds of stuff going on here.
But in the same giant wolves, all kinds of
yeah, stuff. It's all related. You know, they had crop circles, they had Bigfoot, they had animal mutilations, they had poltergeist activity, which happens a heck of a lot with UFO witnesses, by the way.
Yes, it does.
And that study was trying to figure out how are all these things connected? How do they relate to our version of reality? Because really, they're telling us reality is far more complicated. It's far more interesting. The cosmos is far bigger than we might have imagined. I think eventually that is where the Intel and Armed Services committees will have to be. Now, maybe they only will study the national security implications, but hopefully they will fund a permanent program that can look at broader aspects of this. It shouldn't be the job of the Department of Defense to figure out why people who see UFOs have poltergeist type activity in their homes. That's DOD is not going to do that. Somebody should, though. Somebody should figure that out.
Well, you know, it's so very different from where we are now, and it's where we should be in the general media, I think. We're looking at this as mysterious technology, and that's the right place to be. But, you know, when you get a guy with an implant in his ear that works, and I know how to use it since I learned in 2015, I've written three books, Afterlife Revolution, A New World, and Jesus, A New Vision. One is about interfacing with our own dead, which is a huge part of the whole close encounter experience, as you both know. Yep. The other is, what do they want and how can we give it to them if we want to do that? And the third one is, how do we, if we are no longer interested in religion, and most of us are not, how do we take advantage of the relationship with the good that Jesus taught? And that's a trajectory. It's a contact trajectory is actually what it is, of an incredibly different kind than anyone might expect. Now, with that in mind, and we're going to conclude here in just a couple of minutes, and I want to thank you guys for lavishing all of this time on me. I know you don't have much. Where do you see us going from here? And I'm talking, guys, in a visionary way. What is your best vision of the future of this, Jeremy?
Well, I'm greedy. I want to learn as much as I can before I kick the bucket. So we're not promised the next day. And the level of stress I'm at right now, it's not going to be long if I don't take care of myself. So I'm so excited. I just want to learn as much as we can. You know, honestly, I can't say I'm doing all this for the greater public good. I'm doing what I'm doing because I want to learn more. I want to see where this lands, you know. What is our role in this kind of cosmic theater where we're constantly looking out and seeing further and further star systems and planets? Like, what does it mean to be a human at this time? You know, are these coincidences that we're experiencing, are they touchstones and guides? You know, is the whole reality that we engage something that is interactive with our desire? That's a huge question for me. It appears to be. It's so cool. So I don't know. I think fundamentally for me, I would like to see just transparency with what we do know. And if we get that, because look, remember, any government that is put into power by the people represent the desires and the needs of those people. So if that's the case, the American government certainly has a duty to inform the public of precisely what they know about the UFO mystery. So with that said, I'm just excited. I just want to learn more in the short time that we have, because I think that it helps us to navigate this experience that we call life.
It's beautifully said. George, I have a little different approach for you. When you think about things like gravitic propulsion and the metamaterials and what things like element 115 may mean, or I've got a piece of the debris that was in Arts Parts right here, and we've studied it at Southwest Research, and it's fascinating because it's layered bismuth and magnesium, and if you look at it under even a 600 power microscope, there's nothing between the layers. It's the same something that Linda Moulton Howe sold to TTSA. I didn't want to sell mine because I don't have any guarantee that any results would come out. You know, until I'm sure that that's no longer going to disappear into a classified world, I'm keeping it. In any case, I'm not going to sell it anyway. I'll give it to someone who is the right person. Anyway, what happens to our technology? Because right now there are millions of people all over this planet, including a lot of very informed, brilliant scientists who've always before assumed this was nonsense. And they've seen 60 Minutes and they've seen all these stories. Now they know it's not nonsense. What do you see maybe happening here? I see an incredible renaissance in scientific work. You see any signs of that outside of the little community that is now working on it?
Not yet, but it's coming. You know, we've had this stuff for a long time. You know it, Whitley. You know it. We've had this stuff for a long time, and we haven't figured it out. It's almost like they threw a cell phone into a monkey cage that, hey, knock yourself out, chimpanzees. You figure out this phone. We haven't figured it out. I don't believe we have. We have had this stuff, I think, as along with bodies and along with intact craft for a long time. And it's kept a very small group. They don't admit it. They haven't invested the resources that it deserves to figure out the technology, because the effects of that technology would be profound. How many times have we read about these alien editorials that contactees have? They get taken aboard a ship and then they get lectured. Hey, take care of your planet. Knock it off with these nuclear weapons. You guys are going to face destruction if you don't clean up your act. And reporters and senators or whoever hears this stuff, oh, what a quaint alien nonsense story that is. It's true. So yeah, the potential for bringing this stuff out of the closet, letting the scientific community at large take a look at it instead of stashing it in a closet where an aerospace company leaves it and brings it out every couple of years just to see if we've advanced enough to figure it out. It deserves the potential for the technology could change the planet, could reverse the damage that we're doing. It deserves to be out in the light, and it might save us. In general, I am not hopeful. I look around our planet, and I am not hopeful that that will happen. We seem to, the whole country, our country is stooped in ignorance. We're supposed to be the guiding light for the world. We're stupid. We look stupid to the rest of the world. And I'm not, the potential is there to do something really great. Will it happen? I'm not hopeful. We're marching right off the edge of the cliff. I'll say this, and you, this is something that you learned a long time before me, Whitley, but the point at which you realize that this is real changes your life. You know, I've had those points where I've learned things in the life in the course of this investigation. I'm chasing the story and talking to witnesses and gathering documents and having conversations behind the scenes and trying to learn as much as I can. When you realize that it is real, it's a moment where you have to go sit down and think about it for a while. And it's happened to me twice. And it changes. It changes how you look at everything. And I think that would happen to our society if once they learn enough, once we get up the learning curve where it is allowed to sink in. I wish that would happen. I am not hopeful that will happen because I look around and I see so much nonsense.
You know? Yeah. Well, one thing that is very clear about this presence, it does want us to survive. That is very clear. What its motives are not clear. It may be that it wants us to survive because John Lear is right. They're soul eaters or some crazy thing like that. But I think not. I think it wants us to survive for another reason. And that goes way back to an article in the magazine Science in 1977 written by two scientists, two astronomers, D.B.H. Kuiper and Mark Morris, that said that essentially anyone coming here from another world would have so much knowledge, the only thing they would want from us was our own innovations. They would know everything scientifically, but us discovering ourselves and discovering them, that would be why they were here. Gentlemen, I would like to thank the both of you for being with us on Dreamland. It's been wonderful. It'll be we're doing this on the, it'll be this weekend anyway, the 21st, the show will run. And I'm sure we're going to have a wonderful time with it. And I'll send you both ability to enter the site because there are going to be a lot of comments and you may want to respond.
Thank you. If you make it free to the public, I can then advertise that in a big way so people hear, because it's rare when George gives more than 5 minutes on video. This is crazy. So you should make it free to everybody and let me send everybody to you.
I'll do that right away.
Whitley, right. Always good to talk to you.
Good to talk to you guys. Good to talk to you as always, George. Bye now.
Bye. Oh, Whitley, do you want to?
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.